Hi. I'm relieved that not so many people joined this call because the topic is quite complex. Unfortunately, I put the easy tech in the presentation and only realized while writing the talk that it's quite complex problem. About me, I'm Stefan Kuhler. I work for SUSE in the Enterprise Core department. I used to be the release manager of OpenSUSE until the release of Leap, and I'm acting as an OpenQA tools architect and not as a lawyer, so most of the stuff I will tell you is actually bullshit, but take it as an advice from someone who doesn't know licenses to someone else who does not know licenses. And I asked Kieran to be around for overly bullshit stuff that he will correct then, no doubt. The topics of the talk is the whole background of open source licensing, what I describe as licensing hell, and then how we actually handle it within OpenSUSE, the actual process, and I will briefly introduce you to the tool we used that we named Computer-Aided Vicious Licensing, short CAVL. So why are we actually doing legal reviews? Most of you who do packaging will have heard about licensing review, most of them with bad annotations. The problem is that open source comes in many, many flavors, as there's no single, this is open source, but we as a distribution, or even for SD, even as the product, we need to have the license to distribute the source and compile it, patch it to users, and with that, with this review, we're trying to protect the users and the customers from any dangers that would arise from not having correct licenses. So one prime example is if someone puts a license to his code not to be used with commercial offering, then actually SUSE does not have the right to distribute this, and this would also not be open source, so there is no business for the software in Factory, because Factory is, or OpenSUSE Tumbleweed or Leap is supposed to be open source only. So what is open source? As I already said, there is no single definition of open source. There are actually many definitions of what is open source. Most people have a feeling for that. There is, for a long time, I don't know, the FSF propagating free software, which is more than just the source, it's also about the culture and the politics around free software. We had a great keynote on Friday about from the FSFE on how to, on what all these politics come down to. We have the open source initiative that propagates open source, which is different, and there was quite some controversy about this, than what free software is. So open source is more generic than free software is. And OpenSUSE as distribution follows that definition of open source from the open source initiative for code and for content like wallpapers, icon themes, you name it. There are different rules and they are listed in the packaging guidelines. They are mainly about that we know where it's coming from, that there are no trademarks on, no porn. The packaging guidelines even specify that there are better places to get porn. So the open source definition as of the open source initiative, it comes down to four basic points. There's even the actual rules are, as always with licenses, much, much longer. But mainly it is about that it is free for everyone, that as in no money, that the source code is available to modify. This also includes that the code is written as a developer would modify it, not some pre-processing or post-processing happen to the source, that the source allows derivative works. That means you can just take it and do your own stuff with it. And that the source does not discriminate use cases, people, platforms. This discrimination part is actually the longest part of the open source definition, because there are many ways you can discriminate, and they are listed, all of them, in pretty great detail. So on the opensource.org webpage, you also find a list of popular licenses that are used in the wild. They name the Apache, I guess this is alphabetically sorted. So we have the Apache license, which is not only used for Apache, but for a lot of Java packages, for example. You have the BSD3 and BSD2 clause, which is also very often used. You have the GPL from the FSF, and you have the LGPL, which is the lesser or library version of the GPL. You have the MIT license, which is used for X11, and a lot of Ruby stuff also comes in MIT. And you have the Mozilla public license, which is not so much used, but it is very popular because LibreOffice and Firefox are under this license. So as in use of users, Mozilla license will be still be very relevant. So to illustrate the concept of licenses, I find the icons used by Creative Commons quite nice. So this is actually from Wikipedia, if you look up Creative Commons licenses. And at the bottom of the graph, you have the all rights reserved license, which is actually the default if you don't put the license under any, the code under any license. But on the left side of the colors is actually the rights that are added. And the first right that is added on Creative Commons is the right to share the content, or the code in this case, which creates then licenses they call CC by ND or NC for non-commercial. So you can actually, for example, music, you can take a track from an artist and share it as long as you don't sample it or create something that you put your name on it, or that you can share and use whenever there is no costs involved, or no cost to the users involved. The next right there is a remix, and there you also get into the light green stuff, but it's still not open source. Open source only starts when it gets really dark green, because then you add even the right to use in commercial products and to modify in this case. The remix part is already that. And there they have a big difference, and on the top there's public domain, what they call CC0. So it's a pretty long license that says there's no license. There's no, you can do whatever you want. There are other licenses that express this, but CC0 is the more polite form. One of the big problems we are having as distribution is that we are not distributing source, we are actually distributing a distribution which contains big mixes of derived works from open source. So you will find the same implementation of an MD5 checksum in many, many packages. And this license, the original author then picked derives into each package using it. But the licenses that come with these sources are actually mix within this binary, within our distribution. And this mixing of licenses also means mixing of rules, which creates a basically a new license with new set of rules. And not all open source projects are actually aware that you can't blindly mix open source licenses. Some you can, some you can't, but not everyone knows. For example, the version 2 and version 3 of the GPL is actually not compatible, but and this was a big problem for KDE, for example, as we had KDE talks in front, because KDE used to have GPL only version 2, and Zamba came along with only having version 3, and then there was a big problem, and this was, I think KDE resolved this by relicensing to version 2 or 3. But very often licenses have explicit permissions to link certain libraries or certain licenses. One example of a licensing hell I wanted to show you, but I'm not so sure about my time, is this very, very LibreOffice I'm doing the presentation in. If you go to the web page, it says it's free software. If you look deeper, it says it is Mozilla public license. But let's see if my monitor, yeah, I guess this. So this is the about licensing dialogue, which says basically it's Mozilla. But if you look the license of LibreOffice, it's actually 189 pages. And what Kieran, or basically what our legal review process has to do, is reviewing this to verify that there is nothing hidden that actually makes it illegal or impossible to redistribute. I'm still scrolling, by the way. To make it impossible to redistribute LibreOffice in OpenSUSE. So it's, this is what I call licensing hell. And I bet every one of you checked this before using LibreOffice. But fortunately you don't have to, because you can trust my presentation skills. You can trust our licensing review. And so let's skip the rest of this talk and slide. So one thing that came along some years ago is SPDX, which is a common naming for licenses in open source. They have a big list of licenses, and there is some committee deciding when there's a new license coming around, if what name it gets and what the official license text to this license is then, so that as an open source project or as a distribution or as some vendor, I can express my open source licensing in a way everyone understands, because it is now clear. So before we had OpenSUSE called it the Perl license that Perl is under. Fedora still calls it GPL Plus or Artistic, but the SPDX form that everyone then should have is Artistic minus 1.0 or GPL 1.0 plus, which means GPL version 1 or later. And this is just a brief example where you can already see that even the BSD version that some say, okay, I'm BSD, comes in so many flavors that it needs more clarification on what exactly is required from the user or the redistributor. So this is some small statistics I created from the legal license, from the license database, and most of our files in packages are GPL, public domain, or BSD3, but you can see the list is quite long, but it's dominated by only a couple of licenses. Okay, I already lost you, I'm sure. So how do we handle this licensing hell? As part of the development process for basically every SUSE and OpenSUSE project, There is something we call submit requests, you might know, and Legal Auto is some small review bot that is part of this reviewing process, and it reviews in with help of some application the sources and the spec file of the package. And if this combination of licenses is known for this package, it will accept the review. Otherwise, it will wait for a lawyer to review the combination and approve it. And after that, the bot will also approve that. And what the lawyer is using is an external application also that the bot talks to. And this, I will, at the remaining time, introduce this to you. So we called it Cavil after a long brainstorming session on what to name this, because it had a very boring name before. And the reason why I wanted to have a good name is we want to have this application open source. We are not there yet, but we are in the process of polishing it so we can actually show it to someone. This application is fed by review requests from the bot and possibly developers directly, and will check out the sources from the build services, unpack it recursively, and then does on the sources some multi-pattern matching, which means that it knows how a GPL2 is marked in the source, it knows how a GPL3 is marked, how a BSD is marked, and it will do this pattern matching quite quick, and it will then present the lawyers a summary on what files, what licenses were found in what files, and how the combination looks like. The licenses within this tool have a risk associated to it, so that they are grouped from more important to less important, and each license has a different a series of pattern associated to it. The reason why we need several, I will explain soon enough. All the patterns are checked in parallel on the sources, and the longest version wins. If the README says it's licensed under the GPL, we have a license that is called GPL unspecified, which needs more research. We have, if the text says licensed under the GPL version 2, then we name this GPL 2.0, and this means only version 2. But if it says licensed under the GPL version 2 or later, then we add a plus to the license, because then we can mix it with GPL 3. The patterns allow to have a magic keyword called skip that allows to ignore an amount of words within the license or without the text. So this is how the legal queue would look like in Cavil. It has the link to the build service request to be reviewed when it was created, the package name, and some summary on the license report, as we call them, but basically the combination. One of these reports for NASM would look like this. They have there are several licenses that yet you can see, but the most prominent is the purple part. The low risk keywords and the all rights reserved are just noise in some sense. So the purple part is BSD2 clause, and that's also what the spec file says. So the review would be rather quick. But there's one GPL2.0 file in there, and the reviewer has to check how this file is actually used. If this is only a test case, then this is okay because it's not shipped as part of the binary. If it's content, it's also a different story, but if it's part of the sources, then the overall license changes. So this has to be reviewed by someone who's really experienced with all these licenses mixing. Fortunately enough, we have even more than one. So the main story is, why is this taking so long? Everyone, or not everyone, but quite some people complain that the legal review is taking too long or very long. And as I try to explain, the situation is quite complex. And for every file in the source code, we have to identify the license that this very file is under. And then we have to find the combination of sources that create certain binaries, and then determine from there the legal consequences that has. So very often, part of the review is finding the build process and finding what library are used in what binary, or if certain files or patches are applied or not. And so this takes a long time for more complex packages than what I showed you. And there's no one working full-time on that, and no human soul should work full-time on this. Because this is really, if you, and trust me, I tried it, if you do this more often in a row, you tend up to be really grumpy and reject more than you should reject, because yeah, it's just very annoying to see all these stupid upstream projects doing so many stupid things with licenses. And one of the consequences, the stupid things that upstream projects has, is that we have to create repeatedly new patterns for the same license. The GPL, each version has a very specific instruction what you should do if you want to release your source code under GPL. You have to add some very, just copy and paste some boilerplate to each of your sources. And it should be formalized. It should really, really be straightforward pattern matching. Unfortunately, there are literally thousands of variants on how people write the code, this markup. The skip variables already reduce the number of variants that we have, but still, it's insane what people do. And this comes from real people really adding extra clauses to their licenses or to their sources. People adding just random grammar changes that they felt necessary. People that do global search and replace on their sources and unfortunately found a license with that. People adding random typos while opening the editor and or trying to quit Vim, I don't know. So, for example, this is a pretty standard BSD3 license. It has three clauses, and at the end says otherwise there are no warranties, and in no event shall the copyright owner be liable, and blah 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 blah, the typical licensing stuff you click away when you install software. And then you have this, which is basically the same conditions, and I bet you did not even spot the difference, but I blink for you. So it's just its contributors or their contributors. So it's just the same thing in English, but for a machine trying to pattern match, it's really, sorry, was this on video? So this is another example of the same thing where people felt like removing stuff or adding stuff in pretty standard licensing. So we have for this BSD3, we have, I think, 1,500 different patterns that all look very much the same, but are random iterations of this. And it as I said, when you do this more often, it pisses you off. And at some point you want to say to the packager who's innocent, get your upstream projects fixed or I will not review this. So there are some future plans for this application. The most prominent one is that we want to open source the application and release it on GitHub. The actual underlying algorithm is already on GitHub. We need to have these packages associated with a product or a project so we can see actually the status of factory if every package has been reviewed. And we another point why we need this association is so we can clean up stuff that is no longer relevant. And currently the updates are reviewed as basically new packages, so we have to have some diff view. These are the short-term plans. And for longer term, I'm considering investing into machine learning things because the process of defining new patterns is quite boring. And as you can see, the patterns are very similar, so deriving one from the other sounds technically possible to teach to a machine. And the next thing is that I would like to have the bot becoming more smart about what things he can approve on itself instead of waiting for someone, because it looks very, very similar to another package. For example, there are classes of Perl packages and classes of Haskell packages that are basically the same thing. So if we remove my Antonio's time and my technical problems, we have 5 minutes left. So if there's one question, I could answer that. Otherwise, I would leave you for lunch.
Hi. I once was in a nice packaging workshop with my colleague Darix, and then I found out that the Mosquito package that we packaged there is distributed under a license which is called Eclipse Public License. I think I filed a bug about that. And the answer was, look into the license, it's a standard 3 clause BSD license. But the thing is, it's published on the Eclipse website as a copy of the BSD clause under a new name. So, and it's also dual license as under Eclipse distribution license, which is findable in the SPDL format. So what do I do there in such a case? Using the other license or?
So the naming license is very common. So if I write Kevil and release it under GPL, you will find several projects that name this license than the Kevil license. So they in documentation, so they can change the license later without changing the application. And I guess this is one of these cases, but case by case, we have to review if this license actually adds or removes rights from that other license. And this is actually what SPDX does. And if I remember the case correctly, SPDX even had a discussion about it. If this is a new license or just a different name for the same license. So it's case by case.
But they then add not the new name to the SPDX list if it's just a copy.
Okay. Only if it adds or removes rights. Or if it's really, really, really popular already. The SPDX discussions are public.
Albert, what will you do if there's a license update to an existing package? Like if the files change, but the packager doesn't bother updating the field.
Fair question, and I have it prepared, but I guess it's invisible because of my XRender problems. So this is the latest XRDP update to factory, and it is held on legal review because because the licenses did not really change, but to the machinery, there's a new combination. And the reason being is that there is, so this is just to give you another example. So this is already Apache NGPL in the spec file. You can see Apache. I'm not sure if you can see, but I can see it. You can see Apache NGPL, and further below you can see LGPL and MIT, which don't map to the overall result. And there are several other licenses that are for random build tools. So what happened in the XRDP update is it is just a patch level update, but they updated the build system to latest autoconf macros, which and the FSF puts their license in every file. So what this brings now is no longer GPL2 with autoconf exception, but GPL3 with autoconf exception. So this is now a new combination to the tool, and it waits for the lawyer to approve that the update is fine. That's what I mean. We need a diff view quickly, because this it's very hard to find a needle in the hay in this. But this is what we see. We see the package is no longer having the same combination of licenses it used to have, and then we held, and then we halted for a review. And this, unfortunately, goes behind all the other updates.
Make it short. I'll make it short. You said to trust legal review process. You don't have to go. You've indicated that users should be trusting the legal review process instead of reading the licenses. Is that just like cross your fingers, trust, or is there any additional guarantees that the legal review is going to be actually correct?
So if you have legal training, you sure should read the LibreOffice license yourself. But for everyone else, the chances of finding the problems in that license text of LibreOffice is much, much smaller than crossing your fingers. Trust me if I say trust the review process. I mean, this whole process is still not perfect, and as you can see, there's so much noise that it's not so hard to actually miss something. And to my knowledge, no upstream project is using such a process. We are very likely to be the first to actually find it. So, but the good news is, most open source developers have good intentions when they publish their code. So even if they don't use a proper license, but just upload it to GitHub, for them it's already open source. So these good intentions is something that the legal review has to take into account as well. So thank you. Thanks for being patient.